Warm welcome. Hope you all are staying safe and are in best of your health. My ET CFO team is here with me today and we bring to you this webinar, and they join me in thanking all of you for tuning in today. My name is Vartika Rawat, and in this special series, Future of Compliance, we bring to you this exclusive panel discussion on compliance challenges, key concerns for CFOs. For those of you who are new to this Future of Compliance series, our earlier discussions have centered around issues that matter to the finance community, like strengthening key compliance aspects under GST, e-invoicing and ITC claims, ease of compliance, how to simplify and be efficient, and many more. And you can find those discussions on ETCFO website as well. So starting with today's discussion, I am reminded of the time when a CFO once said to me that, you know, doing business in India is like doing business in 29 different countries. This is when he was asked about compliance burden. Now, especially when the government is pushing for e-compliance across the spectrum from tax to audit, CFOs find themselves amidst a twin challenge: protecting the firm from the risk of non-compliance and keeping pace with increasing complexities and stringent regulations. To ensure compliance in this new landscape, CFOs should be able to evaluate and understand data at the most granular level and use advanced analytical techniques to ensure organizational resilience. To explore how to do so and key challenges faced by CFOs, we have with us 6 veteran leaders on today's panel. So please join me in welcoming Arun Kumar Gupta, CFO, Newgen Software Technologies; Hiranand Savlani, CFO, Astral Limited; Ramani Datti, CFO, Team Lease Services; Sachin Darab, CFO, Adagen Life Sciences; Swayam Saurabh, CFO, Ola; and Gauri Shankar Natarajan, EVP Enterprise Business Clear. Welcome to you all. So to start with, I would like to ask the panel, what are the major compliance challenges for CFOs and how does it impact businesses today? So I'll start with Mr. Gupta. Arun, yes, over to you.
So I think today enterprises operate as a global organization wherein compliance requirements are to be met for multiple geographies and multiple types, like subsidiary, oblique branch of organization, keeping in mind the local laws. Thus, the challenge for CFOs are multifold. As an Indian IT product organization with global footprint, we face multiplicity of compliances, including GST, income tax, SEZ, RBI, SEBI, MCA, labor laws. There are plenty, actually, each involving different level of complexities. There are multiple level of assessment, questions from the various government authority to be dealt with. As a listed entity, accuracy and timeliness of the compliances needs to be ensured to provide comfort to board and management. Even employee behavior has to be traced to meet the insider trading norms requirements. This is very essential for building stronger and reliable organization, for scaling up, acquiring new businesses, and for sustainability of organization also.
I can just add something, Vartika, yes, if you permit. So right now I represent an industry where compliance requirements are getting formed. I mean, startups, there are a number of areas where, you know, even government is figuring out what could be, let's say, right way to regulate those businesses. So the other aspect to add here is, I think as CFO, we need to also work with authorities and government in setting up what is right compliance structure. You know, for example, a ride, how should it be taxed? So just wanted to add that aspect versus a traditional business setup.
Right. But, you know, now because we are on you, then, you know, what are the challenges that you see for CFOs and how does it impact your business today?
So, I mean, of course, the first part has already been addressed. The compliance requirements are ever changing, right? So you need to stay updated. As CFO, you need to have a view that the level of compliance your organization is delivering is adequate. But other than that, you know, there are new requirements coming, whether it's SEBI, whether it's financial side, also on business side. And as CFO, you know, you are sort of entrusted to ensure that at no point in time you go wrong, because, you know, organization reputation is involved. There are other risks which come into play. So I go back to basics. I mean, essentially, it's keeping yourself updated using right tools, you know, engagement of entire organization and working with authorities. Right. That broadly, you know, sort of covers it. But challenges are going up because compliance requirements are multiplying.
Right. So multiplicity of compliances, accuracy and timeliness is something that, you know, CFOs are looking forward to. Employee behavior for insider training. And then you said staying updated is really important. And on that note, I'll come to Ramani. What do you think are the challenges for you when we talk about compliance?
Sure. So firstly, organizations are multi-location, multi-entity, multi-business, dynamic and growing. And compliances are complex with too many acts, too many regulators at central, state and local levels with very frequent changes, because it's not just about having the compliances, also the frequency at which these changes are happening. And we need to keep a real-time monitoring of the changes is also equally important. Whereas the current compliance management systems are largely ad hoc, manual, paper driven and people dependent with very limited automation. So the impact of business because of these compliance management systems not being accurate and paper driven is there is lack of accuracy and accountability, which is also leading to the bigger risk of governance and transparency, because non-compliance impacts the trust of all stakeholders, be it your clients, your employees, regulators, investors, shareholders, and in extreme cases, it can impact even the business continuity as well.
Frequent changes need to be tracked on a real-time basis is actually a very important thing that, you know, it's across the spectrum. I'll come to Hiranand. What do you think are the challenges and how is it that impacting your business? Yes.
I think my previous speaker have also spoken that now the business environment is getting challenging and most of the businesses are multi-location within the country also, globally also. So within that environment, it is always a challenging to play a role of a CFO and do the compliance also. So I think multiple challenges are there to every CFO. The biggest challenge is that you don't have expertise in everything. Because today, I think more than 100 acts are there. So many licenses are there, not only at the central level, even state level, district level, even at the panchayat level also compliance is you have to do. So I think within that environment, the biggest challenge is that no one has the expertise. So under that environment, for a CFO to play a role is a big challenge. Secondly, no resources, because you don't have that much of resources being provided by the management or any company to give the attention to all these areas. Because when hundreds of compliances are there, you can't keep so many people in the organization to do all these tasks on a daily basis or on a weekly basis. So that is also another challenge to any CFO. Third thing, what I am saying that the management is unaware about all these things, because no management know that so many compliances is to be done, because management normally is more focused on the business side rather than on the risk on the compliance side. So that is another challenge. To one of the surveys suggest that almost 81% of the management is unaware about the compliances what the organization has to follow. They know the few main compliances, but other than that, there's so many applicable compliances are there where the management even don't know also. So that is another problem. Secondly, very few organizations are digitalized organization, where the companies are digitalized, where still we can say the role of a CFO is much better off than the company, which is mainly, I think previous speaker also said that most of the where we are seeing that on the phone or the papers or the calling, all these things compliances are being done. So it is not a structure compliance, but at least in a bigger organization like us, where we at least follow the digitalizations and all these processes, and now so many good programs, softwares are available, then the life is still much better. I can say it cannot be 100% accurate, but I can say at least in much better position to do that compliance. Otherwise, in a small companies or a medium-sized enterprise, I don't think it is possible to do that part. And another part is that legal updates. Because in our country, so many frequent updates are taking place at every level, at the state level or maybe central level or maybe at the legal side. So getting it updated with you for all this updatation is the another kind of challenge. So now I think It is not a one, I think, challenge which the CFOs are passing through the compliance, but there are multifold challenging. But I think we should take it positively also that side, because we should not see everything with a negative point of view. Because when you are a growing company, you are a big company, being a professional person, it is your also responsibility that you see that how you can best way manage that part. May not be 100%, but at least you can manage majority of the task. I think you are done with that. So I think we should take it positively. And now a lot of softwares are available. A lot of things are available in the public domain whereby you can take the advantage of that and try to see that maximum part you can comply.
Right. So very critical points you've touched upon, you know, lack of expertise at the ground level, lack of resources sometimes. And, you know, 81% of management is unaware of the amount of compliances that the organization have to deal with. So very critical points you've touched, sir. On this note, I'll come to Sachin. Sachin, what do you think are the key challenges? Most of the panelists have already touched upon, but what do you think?
Repeat what others have said. See, as a CFO, I'm responsible for the growth of the business along with the CEO and the board, correct? That's the key parameter for me. So how do you really, as a CFO, how do I walk on the thin line where on the one side, we need to ensure compliance, but just to ensure compliance to its fullest extent, I should not be making the processes bureaucratic, where then people say, my God, compliance is important or business is important. So how as a CFO, I'm able to balance that? That's the biggest challenge for me. People do get, so I work in the pharmaceutical industry. We are a research company and a contract manufacturing company in pharma. So a lot of compliances on safety aspects is a key thing for us. And people do get it. So people understand what is important for them and for the customers. They really don't understand what is important for the company in terms of legal and other compliances. So the biggest challenge, apart from what the other speaker said, is really how to really balance between the bureaucratic aspects of the compliance requirement versus supporting the business growth.
Right. So, you know, Gauri, you know, you must be interacting with a lot of CFOs at your end. What do you think? What has been the feedback at your end about the major compliance challenges around which you're also providing?
Vartika, I think the other panelists have covered most of the very important points, the challenges that CFOs face. I would like to add two more points to that. Right? I think the first one is supply chain and compliance are converging. Right? It's no longer enough that you as a business are compliant, but you also need to ensure your supplier ecosystem, they're also compliant. Right? And that is an additional challenge for a CFO to handle. A lot of my friends spoke about the shift towards digital. Right? I think the journey towards digital also throws interesting challenges for the CFO from a compliance point of view. Right? Because it's now important that your operating system data and the compliance system data are interoperable. They are speaking to each other, and data seamlessly flows from your operating systems into the compliance engine so that your compliance is real-time, accurate, right? So those, I think, are the two additional challenges that I would highlight. Overall, I would say the big challenge in front of the new age CFO is how do we move from compliance purely as managing risk and making sure there's no risk to compliance actually becoming a true business enabler.
I can add one more thing here.
Yes,
that
sir.
Basically, on the compliance side, I think first of all, you have to change the culture of the organization. That is very important, because if you don't change the culture, then people will take it everything lightly. But if you develop that kind of a right culture within the organization, then I don't think it is a big challenge. But unless until that culture is not coming from the top management, then it is very difficult that everybody feel it, that the compliance is very difficult task. But if there is a positive culture within the organization, I think you can manage easily. It is not a difficult task also. But we have to develop that culture, and that too should it come from the top management.
Rightly put, sir. Now that we've, you know, set the context for this discussion, let me move to Mr. Gupta, I mean, Arun. And, you know, Arun, I would like to explore this question from you. Like, Mr. Hiranand just said that, you know, it's a cultural thing. It should come from top to bottom. But, you know, many a times compliance function is considered like a cost center as well. So, you know, compliance as cost saving or compliance as an expense? How do you look at it and why?
So I think when we are talking about compliance, I will say compliance is definitely a cost saving for the organization in the longer term, because timely and accurate compliances avoid all kind of risk and contingency in the future with regard to legal risk, whether it is tangible financial cost like interest, penalty, and intangible cost like brand image, reputation, transparency, fair practices for the organization. So moreover, it is important to de-risk across different countries also. So thus, I strongly believe that we should have proper IT automation tools and a good team to track also, cross-check, do timely and accurate filing, and meet all the requirements. While this does involve time, focus, and cost of the entire organization, but it is essential component of global organizations, especially. Investing in the compliance process by implementing new system, as I think panelists have touched upon also, processes and tools strategically designed to meet both today and tomorrow's risk can help you to keep compliance spending in check. So that's my outlook.
Gauri, would you like to add anything here?
Yes, I think I kind of agree with what Arun just said, right? Just like you have moved every part of the business cost into actually a business enabler. I mean, we talked about supply chain moved towards supply chain optimization, right? Like that, compliance is also moving from becoming a pure expense to a business enabler and helps enable business optimization. Case in point, for example, how you reconcile, right, your purchase register data with the two-way data on time, right, and making sure your vendors are filing their compliances on time can help you unlock working capital, right? So compliance is no longer just a cost of doing business. It can actually become a true business enabler. So I kind of agree with what Arun just said.
Hiranand, I would, like to ask you the question here that, how can organizations apply artificial intelligence, machine learning, advanced technological tools for actionable insights? I know you also highlighted the fact that, many organizations lack those digital infrastructure. But, when you do, then how do you, apply that?
I think AI is definitely going to help to improve your compliance side, because ultimately it is increase the effectiveness of the compliances. And secondly, it is reduce your cost also. Secondly, it reduce the human error, because most of the cases we have observed that human do regularly errors. So if you can use this AI kind of tool or ML kind of tools, I think that definitely it is going to help the organization to improve the compliance part. Without that, I think managing a multiple data, because now the data part is so huge. Within that data part, if you have to do the compliance, then you need the support of these kind of tools. Otherwise, it is very difficult to manage the data also. And particularly when the repetitive data kind of things are there and the masses of data are there, at that point of time, I think AI and these kind of tools definitely help the organization to improve the compliance part.
Right. All right. At the starting of the conversation, when we were setting the context, Ramani, you highlighted a very relevant point, saying that, lack of accuracy can also impact governance, which is very core to the compliance as well. So, I would like to ask you here that, how can compliance teams review existing controls and, shape new strategies?
Sure, Vartika. But before I answer this question, I just want to add one more point on the cost of compliance.
Yes.
Because we internally say this a lot. If you think compliance is expensive, just try non-compliance once. Because non-compliance is not just paying some penalties or some late charges. It impacts the reputation of the company. While the compliance comes with certain amount of cost, non-compliance is way too expensive, not just in terms of the penalties or late charges, in terms of the impact that it would have on the reputation of the company, the brand, trust of the stakeholders, and even the business continuity aspect. So compliance management is non-negotiable. And how do we review the existing controls around this compliance management? We have to view it under three aspects, Vartika. So the first one is whether the compliance management system is comprehensive enough or not. Because in India, there are 1,500 acts, 3,000 filings, and over 60,000 compliances applicable. And again, governed by central, state, and local bodies. So the comprehensiveness, the completeness of all these compliances, whatever that is applicable to the organization, has to be very clear. The second one is whether the systems are personalized to the organization or not, because again, the applicable compliances change based on the industry that the company is operating in, what lines of business they are into, the locations, what all regulatory bodies govern these particular locations and industries and businesses, and how frequently are these compliances to be done, because there are few compliances and filings to be done on a monthly basis, few on a quarterly basis, few annual. So all of these have to be tracked. Last but not the least, which I have mentioned earlier in my comment, is the real-time tracking. Because again, since compliance is non-negotiable and many a time some of these compliance changes come with retrospective impact also. So we need to keep real-time track of what all changes that are happening to the applicable compliance systems.
Right, so comprehensiveness, personalization, and real-timeliness tracking, right? Very valid point here. So, again, I'll put up a question to the panel here, and I'll ask them that, you know, how do you as a CFO evaluate the cost of strengthening the risk and compliance function? What are the factors that influence that decision on your part? So I'll come to Swayam. What do you think?
Sure. So I think it's partly cultural. Because every organization has, a certain history, certain management mindset, certain culture, and also certain complexity. I mean, a mining company has far more different compliance requirement versus, let's say, a startup, right? So what I have learned personally is, your assessment on where you are in terms of gaining confidence from your compliance level tells you if there are for the investments needed. So, I'll use an example. In one of my previous roles, I was CFO for, India's largest mining company. And after I landed there, I realized the total number of questions which entire organization has to answer every month or quarter runs into 65,000. Now, everything was human driven. So somebody sitting in one location was saying, yes, this is done or not done. The question I had for me is, when I go back to, audit committee or listed entity, how do I give them confidence that, we are, let's say, largely compliant? And then I realized that the investment which this organization should have done, given complexity and, the regulatory framework it operates in, has not been done. Investment on people, investment on capability, also investment on tooling. So that sort of gave me my path to go to. I'm sure for different industry, it is different. But I think CFOs, the most crucial thing is actually to sit and assess how confident they are on the overall compliance level. And that, I think, with time largely gives them an answer where investment needs to happen.
Right. Sachin, what is your view on this?
What Swayam said, and I'm experiencing it every day. We are a highly regulated pharmaceutical industry. And the requirement of compliance in this industry are actually very, very high. And in some cases, the compliance requirements are checked by our customers, because for them, we are one of their suppliers. So they are concerned whether as a supplier, we are compliant with some of these regulations or not. So there is a good cultural awareness amongst the people about the safety, because everybody basically comes from the industry. But again, what we are also evaluating as an overall risk, because for us also, it runs into thousands of different aspects, because all sorts of pollution control and chemical factories and every damn thing in the world is actually applicable to us. So which are really critical, which can involve, say, a life and death situation? Is it a risk, non-compliance? Is it a risk to the employees working in the, is it a safety risk for us and the product? That's the most critical on our radar. And when we try to do that, basically that helps us manage the cost as well as the time spent by different people, because we do have a good technology in place, but finally, this is the thing which is managed by people and the processes. And unless we invest on the processes, I'll not call it a cost, it's an investment. Unless we invest on the right processes and right tools, we can't be ensuring that we are compliant. So for me, it's more an investment. If I don't do investment, I lose my customers. It's as simple as that.
Arun, do you have anything to add here?
Yeah, surely, why not? I think as a listed company, I think our problem is also the same. We are accountable to all kind of stakeholders, whether it is shareholder, retail, institutional, independent, board, promoters, vendor, customer. So we need to ensure that we provide all the right comfort to all the stakeholders in order to be successful and maintain the corporate image. Thus, one need to evaluate the extent of current and future risk as well as contingency, both tangible and intangible, in order to compare with the cost of strengthening the risk and compliance function. When implementing new policy, procedures or systems for the organization, one of the best thing one can look to look ahead to where you see the organization in 5 or 10 years and assess whether your current controls would suffice in that environment or not. So that is very important.
Right. If I can add something, Vartika, something from my perspective. You know, for CFOs, we all know compliance is very close to our heart. I mean, because there's nobody in the organization effectively who is responsible for compliance other than CFO, in a way. There can be tendency of going overboard about it in terms of investment. And again, something I've seen very closely, at least in organizations which has, let's say, rich legacy, 60, 80, 100 years of experience, you would see a lot of ineffective compliance cost built in. And I think that's where right tooling, digitization comes in, and leveraging this right will eventually help organization balance the investment made and the level of compliance delivered.
Right.
I can also add one thing here, that to comply on a regular basis and to continuously improve that part, I think we should always welcome the third party independent audit, and we should take their report very positively and seriously and continuously educate your team member that this is a must requirement. We cannot ignore that part. And initially I said that we have to develop that kind of culture so that they take it very positively. So I think continuously it's an improvement require every stage, because you cannot put everything on one goal. Okay, so you need a time also. So some exercises will take 2 years time, some will take 1 year time, some may take 2-3 years time also. So it is a continuous evaluation. So I think we should adopt that practices also, that we should get it audited by third party and regularly you get that kind of report. Because otherwise handling so many departments, so many compliance for a CFO, it is a very difficult job. So I think this can also be a good help to the organization as well as for the CFO to control the risk and the compliance both.
Ramani, what is your view on how do you evaluate the costs of strengthening the risk and compliance function, and what are the factors that influence your decision?
Yeah. Now, on the cost element, I think other panelists have given very valuable inputs, because this is an enabler and also an investment. And while making this investment, we have to think ahead. It's not just for managing compliances of today. If the company is planning to grow 3x, 5x in the next 5 years, 10 years, the compliance system should also be built for that kind of scale, and what are the new lines of businesses that we are entering into. So we need to think ahead and plan the systems also in advance. And as far as the cost management of the compliance is concerned, so again, this is not a problem that can be solved by throwing more bodies or building large teams or hiring all these large consulting firms. So we have to apply a rational approach. First, identify what are the total compliances applicable. Within that, how many are recurring in nature, which are rule-based and filing-based. So those should be focused for immediate automation. They are the low-hanging ones for automation. There'll be some high-quality compliances where we might need to take some interpretations, legal opinions, or get the subject matter experts and Big Fours. But a large part of them can be automated, which are recurring in nature. So we need to apply those logics, like how many of them can be enabled from the backend from automation. What kind of changes can be made in the processes that we are currently doing to enable this kind of recurring and non-recurring automations?
There is a lot of introspection at the end of the CFO, at the CFO's desk, a lot of introspection is needed. And also the cost should be looked at as an investment. And, you know, while doing the introspection, the CFO should evaluate where the third party is required and where isn't, where the teams can come in, right? So, Gauri, do you have any opinion here?
I think of investments on compliance as a continuous evolution, right? If I look at organizations on a spectrum, the most simpler ones are the ones where the compliance and the operating systems are separate, right? And they have humans manual intervention for moving the data between this and ensuring their compliance is happening, right? The next stage of evolution, right, would be what I call as integrated compliance, right, where there is a seamless integration between the operating systems and the compliance systems, and data is flowing through that seamlessly and making sure compliance is happening on time. And I'd say the most advanced evolution from a compliance investment point of view, what I call real-time proactive compliance, right? And here it's not just the integration that happens at an individual transaction level. You are able to take real-time decisions on, hey, what will be the right thing from a compliance point of view? Should I hold the right amount, what's the right amount of TDS should I hold for this vendor, right? Because I have historical data on their compliance, therefore I'll hold a lot. Or should I hold the payment for this vendor based on whether they are compliant or not, right? So that's probably the most advanced level of investment from a compliance point of view. Different organizations are in different levels of this maturity, but I think more and more organizations are moving towards possibly the most advanced stage, which is real-time proactive compliance.
Sachin, let me ask you the question that, you know, how can CFOs ensure organizational resilience with the right compliance tech?
Yeah. See, as I said earlier, while there is a technology and compliance, a lot of tools are recently available, but despite all sorts of precautions and compliance tick marks, something definitely goes wrong. So how do we really learn from that mistake and then improve the internal process? Because finally, as long as the process is strong, that's the biggest resilience guarantee for an organization. Like we have in the past experience, despite all sort of safety precautions and guidelines, still something definitely has gone wrong. There was some little minor hiccups here and there. But those things, how do we really tackle and learn from that and improve our internal processes? That's really helpful. Because what we have seen, we do have a good technology platform for ensuring compliance. There's a decentralized operation. There are individual departments responsible for their own sections and everything like that. But still, finally, it's just ticking the aspect versus really owning that compliance. That's what makes the difference. And that's where people can learn from the mistakes and keep improving the process. That's what we have been doing.
So ticking versus owning the compliance.
Yeah. There's right. A checklist method. So individually, the checklist method has really helped us a lot. Okay, while really ticking that this is compliant, really ensure to go through the checklist as a mandatory requirement. That keeps the things on track.
But Sachin, what are the desired, financial and operational implications of any compliance tech that you would expect?
So in terms of financial implications, in terms of a tech, like how do I mitigate or how do I protect against the most vulnerable areas which have got my financial and accounting impacts definitely on the P&L. But in terms of operational, being a regulated industry, that's more critical for me because a lot of negative impacts can happen in terms of operational challenges, especially on the shop floor as well as with the customers. So the technology, it's just not the technology what we are using. It's just month end or at the end of a specific period, people report compliance. How it can really show me proactive alerts. And how actually it helps me learn from the past records and past such incidences. That's more important in terms of operational readiness there.
Right, valid point, sir. Soyam, I'll come to you here and I'll ask you that, how are CFOs navigating the complex, this complex landscape? And, you also mentioned earlier that, you yourself is in a digitally born business. Where, you said that sometimes you have to help and you have to assist the government to, chart those ways. But, in your view, in your experience, how are you navigating this complex landscape?
No, absolutely. Thanks, Vatika. So I think essentially there are three questions every CFO sort of got to ask himself or herself for them to know if they are navigating well. As far as I know, most of us are struggling simply because the compliances have multiplied and nobody can know for sure Let me just break it down. So the first question is, do I as a CFO know all the relevant compliance requirement at a given point in time? So there are new regulations which comes in. If the answer is yes, and I'll talk about how we are going about it, at least in my case. But this is the first question. I think one has to be clear. I mean, am I missing something? Second is, do I have, you know, somebody talked about process. Do I have right framework, right process, right engagement? Because many of these checklists, I mean, making checklist is one, but making sure checklist is not ticked because it's done by somebody sitting in, you know, one corner of finance department, confirming purchase register, meeting with, you know, your GST returns. Somebody has to say, yes, there is no non-compliance here. And the third, I think it's where I believe a lot of us are struggling is, can I rely? Because, you know, when an organization has hundreds of thousands of compliance requirement, you know, rated, weighted on materiality and criticalness and comes as a summary, can I rely on that? I mean, is it something I can go and present confidently to my audit committee or stakeholders saying, yes, my score is X and I'm confident this is what it is. So it's really making sure that whatever is done is effective and something I can trust. Now, how we are addressing it, at least in our case, and I have seen, you know, organizations like Philips, which is multi-country, multi-regions, very well-settled, quite mature processes, to organization like Hindustan Zinc, which is in highly regulated domain and, you know, has new requirements, compliances coming to a startup where, you know, even government is figuring out its business model and what to tax. So I think the first part clearly is partnering. And I talked about it earlier, internally as well as externally. I think somebody talked about building the right culture, and that starts with CFO. If you ask, if you do a survey in your organization and go ask 500 people who are supposed to fill that checklist, if they find that exciting, I think the honest answer will be 90% will say no. They're just ticking it because once in a quarter they have to do it. So how do you build that culture where people down, you know, down at the ground actually understand that they, you know, sort of doing it right or not doing it right, how does it affect the organization is something they understand. And again, somebody rightly pointed out, starts from the top, but there is no quick fix. And again, you know, sharing my own experience, I've seen different level of maturity when it comes to, you know, management involvement or setting up right culture. It takes time, but it can be done. Externally is more relevant for businesses which are new because, you know, local bodies, authorities, they are still figuring out how to, for example, tax, you know, shared mobility, etc. But that also needs involvement from CFO because you don't want the business model to be burdened with a tax where it gets killed itself. And I have seen this happening in startup in a few different industries. Now, in terms of responding, you know, basically getting confidence that we are able to navigate this whole landscape confidently is one by responding, which includes structure, right? A lot of new gen organizations now take the compliance framework as part of broader, you know, ERM, which is enterprise risk management. Then you have also within the organization linked partly with culture is the whole process of feedback is bottom up. Because, you know, the people who are on the ground actually know if they've complied or not. And again, this can be created as part of framework, something I've seen working very well earlier, something I'm trying to build here. Then effectiveness of management review, you know, engagement of management, making sure that, you know, I as CFO actually understands that out of those 500, these six are critical. And, you know, how do I keep a tab on them? How does that get reviewed? Corrective actions gets taken. So it's a lot of, you know, the execution rigor. With right management attention, people also start to value it. And then lastly, an assurance framework. Somebody talked about using third party to do audits and checks. I completely support it because no matter how well you design your processes and, you know, how effective you are in your review and tracking, a third party assurance always gives you confidence. But, you know, this still does not answer one of the biggest question which was earlier asked, is how do you know your compliance framework is relevant? You're not missing out on something which has come new. And two, how do you know that you're not over-investing in coming to a certain level of compliance? I think that's where tooling and digitization come in. I'm a huge supporter of that. I think investing ahead of curve in this area would eventually create value for organization. I have seen again this happening We in Ola, we are setting it up. But essentially using right tool where, you know, you have ability to see impact of each of those compliance requirements, people understand them, have right way of analyzing it to see what is relevant, what is not. Because you just can't have 5,000 people in the organization doing this compliance. So leveraging, you know, digital, leveraging analytics better is the way to go. And, you know, that also will give you more confidence because unlike human, the right systems are not prone to errors. But more importantly, this tooling also helps, at least in our case, understand that if there are new compliance requirements, it's always updated. And, you know, that also as CFO, you get confidence on. So overall, I mean, this is the framework I'm using to navigate. But if you ask me, do I get sleepless night? My answer will be yes.
Very mature point of view from you, Swayam. And, you know, you also reflected a few points that Hiranand has said in the earlier conversation about, you know, where he pointed out to a number saying 81% of the management still doesn't know how, the amount of compliance that are doing, where you also said that, you know, right management attention is needed. And effectiveness of the review that you are doing, which obviously you said that, you know, CFOs still have those sleepless nights. Because the amount and the complexities that they have to manage every day. Right, so I'll come to Gauri here and I'll ask him that, you know, Swayam also mentioned about using the right tools and, you know, building that resilience. So how can CFOs ensure organizational resilience with right compliance tech? Gauri.
I briefly spoke about this three-part evolution, right, Pratika, about moving towards a real-time compliance enablement using technology. But if there's one thing that I really want to pick up from an organization resilience point of view, this also something that resonated with a lot of CFOs that I've talked to, is the whole data part. Right, increasingly the making sure the operating systems data and the compliance system data are integrated, they talk to each other, there's no leakage on that, is a very, very important lever for ensuring resilience, organizational resilience on the compliance side. And it's also important for the CFOs to partner with CIOs to make it happen, right? So data management, handling data at scale is going to be a very, very critical critical piece. I'll give you an example. A few days back, I met with the compliance team of a large manufacturing company. Right? They're probably generating lakhs of invoices every month, purchase invoices every month from their suppliers. The team takes at least 4 to 5 days to process that data and reconcile. Right, and more often than not, they're not even able to complete the reconciliation on time before the filing. So, and they're also not able to verify whether they have done the reconciliation completely. Right, one example, which is data at scale. Second, I think we spoke about this example. Are they able to withhold the right amount of TDS or withhold the right amount of payment on time? Not able to, right? Because they're not able to handle data at scale. So from a compliance resilience point of view, I think managing this huge operational data, right, and the integration of this data with the compliance systems, partnering with CIO is going to be a critical role for the CFO in the coming days. That's my perspective on this. Would love to hear other panelists' view also.
I just want to add one more point here, Vartika, on the data aspect, because the compliance documentation and record keeping is also equally important, because many of these compliance audits by regulatory bodies, they can go to up to 8 years, 10 years, 15 years, and some of the records have to be maintained for life. And if I take our own business, so we are in the business of employment outsourcing. So we currently have 2.5 lakh employees live, but over the last 20 years, we have worked with 19 lakh employees. So we have to keep all the compliance documentation of all these 19 lakh employees at any given point in time. So this record keeping and documentation is also equally important.
Right. So, you know, as I've requested the listeners to post their questions, I think as of now, we've received one question from Girish. And the question is for the panel. What is the view of the esteemed panel about the compliance management mandate being driven centrally, or a decentralized approach may ease the burden on a single function? Any one of you would like to take this question?
I can comment here because we have been using this approach to some extent. So while as a CFO, finally to the audit committee and to the board, it's ultimately on my head, on my function as ensuring the compliance. But there is a merit, and we have used for say a lot of compliance aspects on safety. There is a separate dedicated team for a lot of aspects on manufacturing compliance. We do have kind of a shared responsibility. Of course, all the financial, legal, taxation, all the compliances rest in my office for sure. But this has been helping us. And then through an internal audit check, then we keep a check on these decentralized 2 or 3 departments so that what we get is just not a tick mark. But in reality, when they say this certificate is available, it's really available on a real-time basis with them. That's what we have been doing. It's not completely decentralized as the questioner may have been wanting. But it does work, at least in our sector, because it's practically impossible only for CFO's office to ensure compliance in a pharma company, for sure.
I think I can also add what sir said, that we have to categorize the risk part or compliance part into 3 parts: high risk, medium risk, and low risk. As far as the high risk areas are there, where I think centralized control mechanism work very well. But as far as the medium and the low risk areas are that, I think definitely we have to decentralize. Otherwise, if everything will keep centralized, we will become mad. So it is always the both approach is required. A few tasks you should delegate and you should decentralize the thing. And critical task, which is the higher risk, I think we should be controlling through the centralized approach.
So this brings us towards the end of our webinar. And as we close, we would like short 1 to 2 minute concluding remarks from the speakers. So Ramani, would you like to start? Any concluding remarks from your end?
Yes, Vartika. So I think we covered most of the points in the discussion, and it's a very insightful session. There are quite a few good points and key takeaways from this. So the main one is to have a comprehensive framework to make sure that we know the complete and all the applicable compliances that are there for the company. So for that, there are currently many tools available, including our own, like TeamLease. We also have a RegTech tool. Because when we started looking for automation of our compliance system, so we couldn't find many players, and also those players and those tools are specific to certain compliances, like only for taxation or only for secretarial or only for corporate. So we were looking for something which is more comprehensive. So that's when we acquired a company, Aventis, and then later we rebranded it as TeamLease RegTech. So that comprehensiveness, real time, and personalization, these three are the key aspects to be taken into consideration.
Right. Thank you. Swayam, anything from your end? Any concluding remarks?
Yeah, invest in people, invest in tools, stay engaged, do it ahead of curve. That's the only way to go about it.
Right, Sachin.
Yeah, no, I second to what Swayam just said. So right investment and make it more a process and system driven rather than depending on one particular person and then believing in that. I agree with what you said.
Hidanand.
I think we should take it positively rather than considering this as a burden. And it's a continuous evolving process. So we have to every time refine that part and continuously try to improve that part. Whatever wrong being done in the earlier year, we should try to improve that part and keep educating the people. So then I don't think it is a burdensome exercise. Otherwise, if you take it negatively, then everything looks burdensome.
Yeah.
And I can thanks to the panel member that in this session particularly, I honestly say that I also learned a lot from my co-panelist.
See, it's a license to operate. I have worked a lot in pharma industries across the different companies, and especially what I liked in my previous company in Abbott, it's again a global company, is compliance is looked at as a license to operate, not something you have to comply for the sake of it. If you don't comply, you don't have a license to operate. It's as simple as that. That changes the whole dimension.
License to operate, quite catchy. So, Arun, any concluding statements from your end?
So I think for me, compliance is more about managing the risk also. And once you are listed, we are a listed company. So obviously, this parameter becomes much enlarged. even all the stakeholders are always concerned about the risk on the compliances. So obviously, it becomes very important that a centralized checklist control is important. At the same time, technology use is also very important. And I think there is no escape of it. So obviously, we have to be very thoughtful about it, very clear about it, and database also should be there for that.
Right. Gauri, what about you?
I think very insightful session. My key takeaway would be that building a compliance culture from the top is very important. Many panelists also refer to it in today's session. Right? And that culture needs to be backed by investments in the right set of processes, tools, and data management. And that's going to be the way forward for all of us.
Right. So thank you so much, esteemed panelists and ladies and gentlemen. To go beyond the typical CFO role, ET CFO breaks down digital transformation in compliance for a robust, agile, and resilient future. As part of this initiative, Future of Compliance, we'll explore various aspects of compliance with the top CFOs and industry leaders of India Inc. So please stay connected and do subscribe to ET CFO updates every day through our daily newsletter, specially designed for finance professionals, and always, always, always send us your thoughts, feedback, and requests. It is really your feedback that makes ET CFO what it is today. Many, many thanks. Thank you so much and stay tuned.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.